blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story.
Brother Doug, would you take your Bibles with me this evening? And we're going to be done with the music for tonight, guys. Thank you. So find the three places with me in your Bible. Find Genesis chapter 14. Find Psalm 110. And then find Hebrews chapter 7. Genesis 14, Psalm 110, and Hebrews chapter 7. Thank you. Many of you have already sent me emails and a couple of text messages this afternoon, making comments about the service this morning and the message, and I'm thankful that the Lord still works through His Word. It's not the preacher. It's the Word. It's the message that He brings. So thank the Lord for that. I told you this morning that I had 3 points I was going to give you, and Brother Houle threw an absolute hissy fit because I only gave you 2 of those. And so tonight, and I make fun of Brother Houle. You're right, Brother Houle, you're one of 4 people that asked me this afternoon, one phone call and 2 other emails and a text message. One of 4 people. What's that? You need the third one. He's got to preach this week. He needs a message to preach. And no, I'm kidding, Brother Hull. I touched on it briefly. The third point, the first was the glory of God. It can't be duplicated. And I told you that the glory of God without the presence of God is disastrous would be the second. And that was actually the third. I skipped the second. And the second one that I had written in my Bible here was that the glory of God does not replace the presence of God. And I could preach the whole night on that one thought, but we won't because he gave you an earful this morning. And if you want my notes, I can try to give those to you. But that was it, Brother Hull. Did you get it?
Yes, sir.
All right. Genesis 14. Genesis 14. There are passages in our Bible that it would be very unfair to those passages to simply read them by themselves and then pretend to have studied them thoroughly without having first gone elsewhere in the scriptures to see where that topic is found in other places and to combine those passages with the one you're studying. I hope that makes sense to you. What I'm trying to say is, in Hebrews chapter 7, we come across the mention of someone that is mentioned in two other places in our Bible. Now, we already understand that the book of Hebrews is written to who? Hebrews. There we go. If we've learned nothing else in this study, we know now the book of Hebrews is written to Hebrews. It's written to Jewish people. That's important. That's important that you remember that. Because if you were a Gentile living at the time the book of Hebrews was written, there are certain things, specifically what we'll be looking at tonight, that you would have read or heard preached in the New Testament church, and you'd have said, who in the world is Melchizedek? I've never heard of him before. Why does that even matter to me? And can I just tell you that Melchizedek is not mentioned in any book of the Bible addressed to and written specifically to Gentiles. Only in Jewish books of the Bible is Melchizedek mentioned, and only three books total. Okay, so you're in Genesis chapter 14. If you've got Genesis 14, say amen. Amen. All right, if you've got Psalm 110, say amen.
Amen.
And if you've got Hebrews 7, say amen. All right, before we go any farther, we need to pray and ask the Lord for help tonight. I've got a lot to cover, and I'll just be honest with you, I don't know how to cover it. I'm just being honest with you, so we need his help this evening especially. Let's go to him now. Father, you do know we need your help, Lord. You know the vast amount of content that needs to be covered tonight. Lord, I pray that you would help me be able to, in my mind, categorize and organize my thoughts to present to your people. God, and after all of my effort is done, all the studying is done, Lord, we're going to rely completely upon you and through your Holy Spirit to teach and to guide to all truth. And so, Father, we ask you for your help tonight. Would you remove the distractions from this place, Father? Would you speak expressly to our hearts? We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Find Hebrews 7. We'll be there first, and then we'll go back to Genesis and Psalms. Hebrews 7. Now, we need to understand that the references to this man named Melchizedek in Hebrews, it is mentioned to Hebrews because Hebrews recognized Melchizedek. That was a name they were familiar with. That was someone that they had some limited knowledge of. Okay, so let's look at the mention of it in Hebrews, and then we'll go and see what the extent of the knowledge of Melchizedek would have been for the Hebrew. All right, so let's do that. In order to see the first mention of it in Hebrews, we actually have to back up to chapter 5, and here's why. In your Bible, it happens all the time, there are parenthetical sections of Scripture. The narrative of Scripture will be going along addressing a topic, and all of a sudden there'll be a very obvious and abrupt break, and a topic within the topic will be addressed. And then after that, at the end of the parentheses, the original topic will be picked up. In chapter 5, we find in verse 6, chapter 5, verse 6, it says, "As he saith also in another place, Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. That verse is the first verse in your New Testament that mentions this man named Melchizedek. All right, look at verse 10 with me, the same chapter. Called of God and high priest after the order of Melchizedek. And then it says in verse 11, here's how you know that it's going into a parenthetical section of Scripture. Verse 11 says, of whom we have many things to say and hard to be uttered, seeing ye are dull of hearing. Okay, there's the beginning of the parentheses. The topic is Jesus Christ, a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Parentheses. We want to say a lot of things about Melchizedek, but you're dull of hearing, so it's going to be hard for us to utter these things. You need to be slow of speech, quick to hear. You need to be mature, not on the milk of the word. The entire chapter 6 is spoken parenthetically. Takes a break to talk about holding fast the profession of your faith, not going back to your old religion. And then at the close of chapter 6, in verse 20, I love these last three verses are so good. Verse 18 says that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation who have fled for refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul. Amen. An anchor of, you know what that anchor of the soul is? Steadfast and sure? Well, it's fixing to tell you. Anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast, and which entereth into that within the veil. What in the world could our anchor be holding to within the veil? Well, the next verse tells you. Whither the forerunner is for us entered. Even, here it is. Even Jesus made a high priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Buddy, the anchor of my soul. The anchor of my soul rests securely in Jesus Christ, my high priest. I like it. That's good. I could preach it. We won't tonight. Verse 1 of chapter 7 picks up and continues that thought. Jesus Christ, priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. It says in verse 1, for this Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, who met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. Now let's stop right there. Scripture is now talking about an event that the Hebrews were very familiar with. But we're not all Hebrews. In fact, maybe none of us are Hebrews tonight. So let's go back in order to grasp the context of Scripture. Let's go back and read about what the Scriptures are talking about. It's a great idea. It's a great idea. It'll help us. Let's do it. Genesis 14. Go there very, very quickly. Genesis 14. Now, we don't have time to read the entire passage, but we are going to read the passage that talks about Melchizedek. I'm going to read, there's only a couple of verses there. And so you're in chapter 14. Let me tell you what has happened so far. Abraham and his nephew Lot have parted ways. Lot went towards Sodom, the plains of Sodom and Gomorrah. That's where his cattle were grazing. The water was good there. Lot went that direction. Abraham went the other direction and kept his herdsmen and his cattle. They kept them separate. But after a little while, there was an alliance of kings that came up against the cities of the plain. They attacked the cities. They led away captive the inhabitants of the cities. They stole the herds of those inhabitants. Lot was among them. They were attacked and led away. Abraham receives word that his nephew Lot has been captured by these invading armies. And Abraham, hey, if you ever thought Abraham was a sissy, you need to read chapter 14 of Genesis. Abraham heard what took place and didn't send to the next country over to ask for help from the army. He said, I've had enough of this garbage. Hey, go get all the servants, get them all together, put a sword in their hand and tell them we're going to go to fight a battle. Can you imagine? Can you imagine that conversation? Master Abraham has called for all the herdsmen and all the shepherds. He's got a meeting. Something big's happening. He just wants us all around. 300 of them gather around. Abraham says, I'm glad you're my shepherds. I'm glad you're my servants, raising my own house, but your job description has slightly changed today. You are now soldiers. The Bible says that he pursued them. Him and this group of servants turned soldiers pursued the invading army, caught up with them, laid an ambush, and just completely whooped them. I mean, gave them what for. So much so, he beat them and brought back all the captives, brought back all the spoils of war, brought back all that was lost. Abraham was not a sissy. Abraham was a man that knew when to fight. He knew when to do right. He knew how to stand for right. Abraham was a man's man. On the way back home, he comes to Sodom, and there's two men there waiting for him. And that's where we pick up the story in chapter 14. Now, keep in mind, he's just come from battle, and he's got all of Lot's family and all the other captives that were taken. He's got all the spoils of war, and he's got all of his servants walking with him, running security for him. And here's what it says in chapter 14. Let's begin reading in verse 17. Verse 16, just so you know exactly where we're at, it says, "And he brought back all the goods, and also brought again his brother Lot and his goods, and the women also, and the people. And the king of Sodom went out to meet him after his return from the slaughter of Chedorlaomer." Someone say, hey, that was work. Someone say amen. I tried. Thank you. Brother James and Sister Ann, I don't come across a hard name in Scripture that I don't think of your mom. And she pulled me aside of her church one time and said, "Pastor, I appreciate the effort you put into pronouncing these names." Here's what she said. "But you're getting it all wrong." She said, "If you'll come over to my house, I will show you how to read the accent marks and pronounce the names right." I went over, but it didn't stick. I just forgotten everything. So these kings go out to meet him, and I've lost my place here. Verse 18. "And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth bread and wine. And he was the priest of the Most High God, and he blessed him and said, 'Blessed be Abram of the Most High God, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be the Most High God, which hath delivered thine enemies into thy hand, and he gave him tithes of all. And the king of Sodom said unto Abram, Give me the persons and take the goods to thyself.'" Boy, Abraham's a man of integrity. Look what he says in verse 22. "And Abram said to the king of Sodom, I have lift up mine hand unto the Lord, the Most High God, the possessor of heaven and earth, that I will not take from a thread even to a shoe latchet, and that I will not take anything that is thine, lest thou should say, I have made Abram rich, save only that which the young men have eaten and the portion of the men which went with me." And he lists some men here. Here's what takes place. Abram's returning. The king of Sodom and the king of Salem come out to meet him. The king of Salem blesses Abram. Abram gives a tenth of the spoils to Melchizedek. And then he turns and gives the rest of the spoils to the king of Sodom. Melchizedek, who is, by the Bible's definition, the priest of the Most High God, blesses Abraham, but then turns and blesses God on behalf of Abraham. Let me just put it in park just for a moment and ask you the question, have you ever considered what the job of a priest of the Old Testament was? It was the job of the priest to be the go-between between man and God. There is no formal way of worship set up here. I do not care what you say. You cannot prove to me biblical tithing from this passage of Scripture. It's not there. All we find is this man blessing Abraham and then turning to God on behalf of Abraham and blessing the Most High God of Abraham. And then Abraham turns to the king of Sodom and says, "The rest is yours." Now, if I could just jump on my hobby horse for a moment. If you want to give 10% of your money to the work of the Lord, help yourself. My wife and I have used the 10% model as the base of our giving ever since we've been married. It's 10% and upward. I'm not saying that's wrong. What I'm saying is, if Abraham giving 10% to Melchizedek is supposed to represent the model, then we got a problem, because Melchizedek turned and gave 90% to the king of Sodom. And so if you're going to use this verse as your bedrock doctrine for tithing, then what you ought to do is give your 10% to the Lord and then write Uncle Sam a check for the rest and not complain about it. Crickets chirping. Amen, Pastor. So let's go now to Psalm 110. Psalm 110. I know people don't agree with me. My dad calls me a heretic. I think he's kidding. Psalm 110. We just read in Genesis 14 the first mention of Melchizedek. Now we're going to go to Psalm 110 and read the next mention of Melchizedek. Psalm 110. If you're at Psalm 110, would you say amen? Yes. I had you do that again because I needed more time to get there. Psalm 110. Only one verse is what we need here, because that's the only place that he's mentioned. Psalm 110. It's a prophetic psalm. This is a prophecy. Here's what it says. Let's begin reading in verse 3. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power, in the beauties of holiness from the womb of the morning. Thou hast the dew of thy youth. The Lord hath sworn and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. That's it. That's all there is in your Old Testament about this mysterious character called Melchizedek. Now, the next time we read his name, it's in the book of Hebrews, and our Savior, our great high priest, is being compared to this man. I'm going to throw a big word out at you. How many of you ever heard the word Christophany? A few of you have. Christophany is a word to describe the appearance of Christ in bodily form in your Old Testament. Okay? People argue that when Abraham and Sarah had the visitors that came to tell them about the birth of Isaac and about the destruction of Sodom, there are people who say that one of those visitors was Christ, a Christophany of the Old Testament. People say that the Hebrew children thrown into the fiery furnace, a fourth man walking, and it was likened to the Son of God. They say this was a Christophany in your Old Testament. I'm not here to argue or debate the point of whether those are true Christophanies or not. It doesn't matter for our purposes tonight. What I will say is, we better be careful what liberty we take with Scripture in assuming certain things. Now, the only reason somebody would say that Melchizedek is Christ manifest in the Old Testament, the only support they would have for that argument is the references in Psalm and Hebrews about Christ being a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And there are some who would make that argument. It is my position, and I told you, I'm not going to argue it. It doesn't really matter. I don't believe Melchizedek was Christ in the Old Testament. I don't believe that. One of the reasons I say that is in chapter 14 of Genesis, it says that Melchizedek was the king of Salem, and then it says the king of Sodom. No one's arguing that the king of Sodom was anything other than a man. Why would we argue that the king of Salem was anything but a man? And again, it doesn't really matter. So now we're back to Hebrews chapter 7. Now let's leave Scripture in the context that the Holy Spirit of God gave it. I believe it's much richer, it's much more exciting and valuable when we do that. There are some great messages that have been preached on Melchizedek and all, and I'm not able to do that like a lot of men. But there's a couple of things, several things in these couple of chapters we need to see very, very quickly. Is it really 10 till? It is. I don't say that to acknowledge I'm going to end in 10 minutes. I just wanted to acknowledge the time. Chapter 5, verse 6, you might underline or highlight the words. These are very important words, the common words, common theme throughout these couple chapters. Might want to make note of the words in verse 6, after the order of Melchizedek. In chapter 5, verse 10, the words, after the order of Melchizedek. In chapter 7, verse, I'm sorry, chapter 6, verse 20, the word after the order of Melchizedek. In chapter 7, verse 3, the phrase, but made like unto the Son of God. In chapter 7 and verse 11, the phrase after the order of Melchizedek. And then the phrase a little bit later on in that same verse, after the order of Aaron. Verse 15, the phrase after the similitude of Melchizedek. Verse 17, ever after the order of Melchizedek. Verse 21, after the order of Melchizedek. Do you see the theme here? The common thought is Jesus Christ is after the order of, after the similitude of, like unto. If he's like unto something, he is not that very thing. I believe that the Bible is reaching way back before the Old Testament law to an incident and an individual that all Hebrews would understand, grabbing that individual, bringing him forward and saying, this will be the new example of what God is doing. Okay? Now, I've made my notes four times trying to organize and figure out how in the world we can do this effectively, and I still don't know. I've got my type notes here, and I've still got my notepad somewhere here. I don't know where I've left it. We're in trouble. We're over here. I don't know what we're going to do now. We're just going to kind of read the scripture and trust the Holy Ghost to make up for where your preacher falls short this evening, all right? So let's go to Genesis chapter 7. And given what we just read in Genesis, I'm sorry, Hebrews chapter 7, and Genesis 14. Given what we've read in these other places, let's just very quickly make a quick, brief list of what we know for sure about Melchizedek according to Scripture. Number one, according to Hebrews 7:4, in Genesis 14, 17, he was a man. That's all the Bible says, is that he was a man. Secondly, he has no genealogical record given. Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 3, if you look there, it says, without father, without mother, without descent, having neither beginning of days nor end of life, but made like unto the Son of God, abideth a priest continually. So Jesus Christ and this Melchizedek were much the same, because Melchizedek's genealogical record, his descent, his ancestry, it's not given, it's not recorded. They don't know where he came from. Keep in mind that your book of Genesis is the same book of Genesis. It contains all the same information that the Hebrews would have studied. They don't know any more than we know about Melchizedek. It's thousands of years before. But what they do know is Melchizedek came on the scene, and two verses later, he's off the scene. Don't know who his mother was. Don't know who his father was. Don't know what area he came from. We don't know anything about his rule of Salem. He's without descent. All right, look, what else do we know about Melchizedek? Number four, according to Hebrews 7, verse 2, he was called King of Righteousness first, and then he was also called the King of Peace. That's both in verse 2. It says, to whom also Abraham gave a tenth part of all, first being by interpretation King of Righteousness, and after that also King of Salem, which is King of Peace. We understand that he was made like unto the Son of God, and not in his person, but rather in his genealogical record. In his descent, he was just the same as Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ was from everlasting and to everlasting, the Bible says. And Melchizedek came on the scene, left off the scene, just this exact same way. We understand that he was a priest of the Most High God. We understand that from Scripture. The Bible says that he was a go-between between Abraham and the Most High God. We understand that he was a king, an earthly king. He had an earthly kingdom, the King of Salem. That's what he was. It wasn't a spiritual kingdom. It was an earthly kingdom. The Bible makes it very, very clear. We understand that he blessed Abraham. In chapter 14 of Genesis, in verse 19, he blessed Abraham. And we find that just after that, that he received tithes from Abraham. And then we understand that he blessed the Most High God on Abram's behalf. That is what we know about Melchizedek. Those are what we know. Now, here's what I'll tell you. Pastor Story has given me lots of commentaries. He's given me some outlines by pastors and preachers. He's known that some of the paper's all yellowed, and I'm afraid to even handle some of these. They're so old. And there's no shortage of opinions on Melchizedek. There's no shortage. But now let's read through chapter 7 of Hebrews. We'll go fairly quickly. And let's just let the Bible make the comparisons, and let's understand who Jesus Christ was to the Hebrews. All right? In light of their knowledge of Melchizedek, let's understand who Jesus Christ was compared to him. Now keep in mind, in Deuteronomy chapter 6, the Israelites are told, teach your children the law of God. Teach them the scriptures. When you're walking together, you teach them. When you're getting ready to go to bed, you teach them. When you're sitting to eat, you teach them. So what I'm saying is Genesis chapter 14 had been taught and passed down to the Hebrews. They knew it in their synagogues and in the temple. It was read and taught. The writings of Moses were elevated to really, and it sounds bad, but an ungodly level. People knew who Melchizedek was. Now, Hebrews chapter 7 says in verse 4, now consider how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave the tenth of the spoils. Abraham's not a great man in my eyes. I mean, he's not a hero of mine, but he was to the Hebrews. But he was a national hero. Hero. That's what he was. Look at verse 5. And verily, they that are of the sons of Levi, who receive of the office of the priesthood, have a commandment to take tithes of the people according to the law, that is, of their brethren, though they come out of the loins of Abraham. But he whose descent is not counted from them received tithes of Abraham and blessed him that had the promises. So here's what the writer is saying. He's saying, all of the Hebrews came from the loins of Abraham. They trace their lineage back to Abraham. They hail Abraham as the most exalted and the most renowned man as a patriarch. And then the writer says, but we need to remember that even Abraham was inferior to Melchizedek. And just as Abraham paid tithes to Melchizedek, because Melchizedek was superior, he's getting ready to say, so is our great high priest superior to all of the law in the Old Testament. It gets good. It gets really, really good. So he just said, he received tithes of him and blessed him. Now look at what it says here. It says, without contradiction. In other words, there's no dispute. No one can argue. Verse 7. And without all contradiction, the less is blessed of the better. Man, it seems like the writer is trying to insult the Hebrews. He says no one can argue that a superior person does not go to an inferior person and say, please bless me. No. The lesser always goes to the greater for the blessing. And here's Abraham, the great patriarch Abraham, mighty warrior Abraham, returning from battle, and he comes and gives 10% of the spoils to Melchizedek, and then humbles himself as he receives from the greater a blessing. Paul is telling the Hebrews, Abraham is great, but he's not the greatest. That's right. Right. Abraham was a great man. In fact, chapter 11, the same writer says he's a hero of the faith, but he wasn't the greatest. You understand the difference there. Look what it says next. It says the less is blessed of the greater. Verse 8, and here men that die receive tithes, but there he receiveth them of whom it is witnessed that he liveth. Notice he does not say with all surety that he never died. He just said it's commonly accepted. People just commonly accept that there's no way of knowing what descendants he left. No one knows when he died. No one knows. He says it's a lot like our new great high priest. A lot like our great high priest. Look what else it says, verse 9, and as I may so say, Levi also, who receiveth tithes, paid tithes in Abraham. And this is good here, but you gotta follow this train of thought, okay? And keep in mind, Abraham lived almost 500 years later. The children of Israel, Abraham's descendants, never met Abraham, but they knew who Abraham was. Those descendants left Egypt. Then just after that, the law was given, priesthood set up, and tithes began to be paid to the priests, the Levites. All right, look what it says. And as I may so say, Levi also, who receiveth tithes, paid tithes in Abram. Did you catch it? Paid tithes. He's saying that all of the descendants, whether they ever knew Abraham or not, because they're his descendants, they're all inferior to Melchizedek. They all paid tithes through their ancestors and leading up to Abraham. Look at verse 10. For he was yet in the loins of his father when Melchizedek met him. If therefore perfection were by the Levitical priesthood, for under it the people received the law, what further need was there that another priest should rise after the order of Melchizedek and not be called after the order of Aaron? I like this. We're getting ready. Hey, the next verse ought to make you shout. Man, it ought to make you shout. Look what it says there. Verse 12, for the priesthood being changed. You know when that change took place? On a hill called Calvary, when our Savior poured out his blood, fulfilling all righteousness, the veil of the temple was rent in half. And at that point, the old priesthood became obsolete. It's a new priesthood. The old priesthood being changed, there is made of necessity a change also of the law. Thank God. Hey, the old law, hey, it was righteous. It was a strong law. But me and Brother Alex are studying chapter 8 of Romans right now. And that book, that chapter 8 of Romans says that the law was weak. It was weak. It could not save people. All it did was condemn people. Thank God that with the change of priesthood came a change of law. There was a law of death, a law of sin, but now there's a law of life, a law of grace. Thank God for the new law. I'm saved not by my good works according to the law. I'm saved according to the grace of God who extended his son to be my great high priest. Praise his name. The old is gone. We don't need it. And the admonition to the Hebrews is the same. Don't go back to it. You've got a great high priest now. Yes. Don't go back to the old. The old is finished. Just cling to the new. Look at the next verse. I told you it gets good. The next verse. Look at verse 13. For he spoke, for he of whom these things are spoken pertaineth to another tribe of which no man gave attendance at the altar. I like it. Hey, remember in Philippians chapter 3 what Paul's boasting was? Remember, and he wasn't bragging, but he said, if I wanted to brag, I could brag. He said, I trace my lineage all the way back to Father Abraham. Over and over again, people's lineage, where they came from, was important. Man, the priest said, well, I'm a priest of the tribe of Levi. I am God's chosen priest. Man, they were proud of it. The writer just came on the scene and said, some pagan man outside the nation of Israel named Melchizedek is a better example of the great high priest than any Jewish priest has ever been. He says, hey, you couldn't compare him to a priest, because our great high priest, his tribe, his lineage was never represented by a man around the altar. It was never there. He was totally different. And he must just be pouring salt into the wound of some of these Hebrews who cling so dearly to their Old Testament religion. He's a lion of the tribe of Judah. I'm thankful I have a high priest who doesn't trace his lineage back to those who served around a stone altar or a golden altar I'm thankful for that. You should be too. Paul says, our high priest was never represented there. This is an outsider. And now we begin to see the comparison to Melchizedek. Because for thousands of years, the Jewish people lived under a law that said no one other than the tribe of Levi, the sons of Aaron, could be a priest. No one's allowed. So the Holy Spirit says, I've got the perfect example of who I can compare the new priesthood to. Let me get a non-Hebrew. Someone they'll understand. Someone with so many similarities, it'll be a perfect comparison. And so let me just say this about the sovereignty of Scripture. I do not believe that so little is known about Melchizedek because of bad record keeping. I think it's exactly the way it is in Scripture, so that thousands of years later, the Holy Spirit could say, now it's time to use Melchizedek. Let me show you why I put Melchizedek in the Bible. I thank the Lord for it. I do. Look what else it says next. It says, not only is his ancestry, his lineage, not only is it not represented around the altar, verse 14, for it is evident that our Lord sprang out of Judah, of which tribe Moses spake nothing concerning priesthood. Nothing. He says, hey, if it was up to Moses, Jesus Christ isn't qualified to offer sacrifice for anybody. But he's not a priest after the order of Aaron. He's a priest after the order, after the similitude, after the pattern of a man named Melchizedek, an outsider, a new kind of priesthood. Look what else it says. You're not getting it like I am, and I love it. This is great. Verse 15, and it is yet far more evident, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there arises another priest, who is made not after the law of carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life. Hey, no priest could ever say, I am a priest administering sacrifice and worship that brings endless life. No priest could ever say that. But my great high priest, who is a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek, didn't come with a law of carnal sin and flesh. He came with a law of life. Praise his name. He is so much better than Aaron ever was. So much better. Look what else happens. Says in verse 17, for he testifieth. Here's a reference to Psalm 110, verse 4. It's a quote right from Psalms 110. We already read it. For he testifieth, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. For there is verily a disannulling of the commandment going before for the weakness and unprofitableness thereof. Amen. That's certainly true. The old commandment, it is weak. It doesn't profit us. Hey, it was a letter of the law. It was death. All it did was show me how imperfect I am. Oh, but verse 19, for the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God. Hey, the Aaronic priesthood, all they did was once a time go into this tent in the wilderness, sprinkle a little blood, and for another year, God Almighty would look past the sins of the people. But come the same time next year, that priest better be ready to go back into the holy place, sprinkle some more blood for himself first, and then the sins of the people, over and over and over. My high priest brought in a better hope. My high priest brought me nigh to God himself. Even after the priest went into the holy place and sprinkled the blood, no one was allowed in that holy place. God would look past their sins for another year, but they could not come nigh unto God. They wouldn't dare step in that holy place because they'd have been killed on the spot. But my high priest, a new priesthood, an unchangeable priesthood, a priesthood that will last forever, brought not the letter of the law, but the law of life and grace, and brought me nigh unto God. Praise his name. Do you understand? A while ago, we got around this altar, began to pray and commune with our Heavenly Father as his children, washed from our sins in the blood of his Son, redeemed from our sin. Thank God. I'll take the new. You can have the old if you want. I'll take the new. It's much better. Look what it says in verse 18. Now, verse 20. And inasmuch as not without an oath he was made priest, for those priests were made without an oath, but this with an oath by him that said unto him, the Lord swear and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Did you catch this? He says those priests out of the line of Aaron, they didn't earn anything. They weren't anything special. God made a promise to Aaron that his sons would be priests. And so Aaron's son became priest, and his son became priest, and his son became priest. There was no picking or choosing. Whatever came along, you're stuck with him. Which is why you come up with priests like Aaron's sons, who two of them were killed by God for their wickedness. And over and over and over you find priests falling short. But God says, I have hand-selected this priest. I have sworn that he'll be priest. I've sworn with an oath. In Psalm 110, he says, I'm swearing that you will forever be a priest after the order of Melchizedek. No other priest ever received an oath like that from God. No other priest ever did. Only my great high priest did. Verse 22, by so much as Jesus made a surety of a better testament, and they truly were many priests because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. I want you to listen to the humor in this argument. The priests of Israel would say, well, we're God's chosen priests. In fact, we can trace our lineage all the way back through centuries and centuries of the right priest. I'm in the right line to be priest. And the writer says, yeah, you know why you're in the right line of the priest? Because you keep dying. Because you're sinful man. Your flesh is like the flesh of everybody else, and given enough time, you're going to die too. But one day, a great high priest stepped on the scene, and he became a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. It says, yeah, there was many of them because they kept dying. God couldn't keep them alive. Sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Yeah, they were just sinful men. Look what it says. Verse 24, but this man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood. There's the immutability of God coming up again right there. You can't change him. What he says is going to be, and when he says something's going to be a certain way, you can't change it. It's immutable. Oh, it's good. Wherefore, he is also able also to save them just a little bit. Hey, if that's what your Bible says, throw it away. My Bible says he's able to save them to the uttermost. Now, you know what that means, don't you? We were commanded to go into all the world to preach the gospel to the uttermost. You remember that, don't you? The Great Commission. There's two ways that verse can be taken. It can be taken that God takes an individual who is polluted and consumed with sin in every nook and cranny of his spiritual heart. He's polluted and he's dirty, and God can save him to the uttermost parts of his sin. God can cleanse him and save him. Or we can say that God in his sovereignty sent forth a high priest that is forever. Forever at the order of Melchizedek, and is able to save the uttermost parts of the world. I believe it. I believe it. He's not just some simple high priest. He's a great and faithful high priest. Hey, church, don't let religion rob you of the joy of our high priest. You don't have to be a Hebrew to get excited about your high priest. I love my high priest. I'm thankful I know him personally. I hope you do too. Save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him. There it is again, John chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And here it is. He's able to save them to the uttermost. They come unto God by him. We see the unity of Scripture there. It says, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them.
Praise God. Thank you, Lord.
Right now in heaven, my great high priest, the Bible says it's the man, Christ Jesus, is making intercession for me. Intercession for me. He is interceding on my behalf to God the Father. Praise his name. Praise his name. Not some frail high priest that has to have an entire line of priests because he's going to die, but he ever liveth making intercession praise the Lord. That couldn't be said of any other priest ever. Ever. No other priest could ever have, it couldn't be said, he ever liveth to make intercession. Every high priest made intercession for the people. Only the great high priest ever liveth making intercession. Look what else it says. Verse 26, 27, and 28, and we're going to read this very quickly. And these verses define, it sums everything up, why our great high priest is so much better. Here it is, verse 26. For such an high priest became us. You know what that means? Doesn't mean that we became the high priest. That word became means benefited us, complimented us. It was good for us. It says, for such a high priest. What kind of high priest? The one we just read about. The one we just described. That high priest, that kind of high priest became us, who is holy. No other high priest has been holy. Mine is. He's holy. He's harmless. Is that what your Bible says? That's what mine says. Our high priest is holy and harmless. Never one time has my high priest wronged me. Never one time has my high priest took advantage of me. Never one time has my high priest had to ask forgiveness for the way he treated me, because he's harmless. He's holy. He's harmless. Look what else it says. Undefiled. Undefiled. Praise God. Praise God. He who knew no sin became sin for us. Amen. He is undefiled. Undefiled. The Passover lamb was to be kept up for a few days, examined, make sure he was without blemish, because a lamb that's going to represent my Savior had to be perfect, undefiled, holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners. Hey, remember those boys we read about this morning in 1 Samuel chapter 4? Those priests who were with the Ark of the Covenant, committing fornication and involved in all adultery and wickedness. Not my high priest. No, my high priest is separate from all that garbage. Separate from sinners. Holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners. Look what else it says. Separate from sinners and made higher than the heavens. I don't know how high that is. Sounds pretty high, though. He's so far above us. His ways are not our ways. Our thoughts are not his thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. Boy, he's laying it to these Hebrews, isn't he? Who needeth not, praise the Lord, needeth not daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice for his own sins and then for the sins for them for the people's sin. For this he did once when he was offered Amen. Up himself. Amen. You know what a typical day in the life of the high priest was? Before dawn, get up bright and early. You go make sure the candle's still burning. You go make sure everything is right in order, make sure everything is set. Before you do anything, before you can intercede for anybody to God, you must first go and offer a sacrifice for your sins every single day. You could not receive an offering to offer to God from somebody until your own sins had been taken care of. Never one time has my high priest had to offer for his own sins. Never one time. He's always interceding for me, always ready to intercede, always waiting, always right there on my behalf. Never has to take care of himself first. And then look what he says in verse 28. For the law maketh men high priests, which have infirmity. But the word of the oath, which was since the law, maketh the Son, capital S, maketh the Son, who is consecrated forevermore. Amen. That's my high priest. That's the one who offered himself for me. He didn't inherit the position. It was sworn to him by God Almighty. And he has faithfully, without fail every day, faithfully fulfilled his role as my great high priest. If you know the Lord tonight as your Savior, would you say amen?
Amen.
Then we have the same high priest.
Yes.
And he's done all that for you. He's not like Aaron. If you got to compare him to somebody, he's more like Melchizedek. A new, unchangeable priesthood. Let's stand together, please. Well, of my 28 references I had in my notes, we got through none of them. You ought to be able to leave this place tonight loving and appreciating your high priest. You should. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes? For such a high priest became us, who was holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, higher than the heavens. That's your high priest. Do you know him tonight? If you were to die right now, do you know for sure? Sir, I don't care how old you are. I don't care where you've been, where you've come from. Ma'am, it doesn't matter how good a person you are. If you were to die right now, can you honestly say you're completely at peace with the relationship you have with God? If you're resting in anything other than the sacrifice of your high priest, then one of these days you're going to open your eyes in a devil's hell where you'll spend eternity. But my high priest sacrificed himself for me and saved me from my sins. And one of these days I'll spend eternity with him in heaven. You can too. If you'd say, preacher, I'm not sure that I'm saved. I'm not sure that I am saved from my sins. Would you please pray for me, preacher? There's no one looking around. I'd like to pray for you, not by name, but I'd like to pray for you. Would you quickly put your hand up and put it right back down? Let me pray for you. Anybody at all? Okay, maybe tonight you'd say, preacher, the word of God has sure given me an appreciation for my high priest. Could I see your hand? Yeah, I'm with you. Father, thank you for your word. Father, thank you for sending your son to carry my iniquity. Thank you for sending him to be bruised and chastised for my sin. God, thank you for giving us your word to show so clearly how perfect our high priest is. Now, Lord, you know the needs of the people tonight. Lord, whatever it might be, would you please take an invitation and do something with it that I couldn't? Please move on hearts, Lord. Let us understand and feel and experience your presence in a very close and real way tonight. In Jesus' name, with your head still bowed and your